Hello and welcome to The Big Picture, the new sports show here on RCTV. My name is Kevin Vendt, and I am your host for this evening's show. My guest tonight is Jonathan Vendt, my brother. It's my brother.
Hey, how's it going?
And one of the things when we first put together The Big Picture as a show is we said, I wanted it to be a show about big picture events in sports. We're not going to talk about this individual game or that individual game. And one of the things that happens when we watch sports, as a lot of guys do when they watch sports, is we talk sports. And we talk about random things sometimes. We don't always necessarily talk about the nitty-gritty of this and that and the other thing. We sometimes just throw out random things.
And we tend to get off topic.
And we tend to get off topic. And so that may happen today, but we have some things that we like to talk about that we're going to talk about today, and hopefully you'll find them a little bit interesting too. But before we get into the things that we like to talk about, I feel as though we have to talk about this year's Red Sox team. To be blunt, this team has been a huge disappointment for almost everyone and anyone that follows the Red Sox, especially on the throes of what happened last year at the end of the season and with the successful years they had before that. Well, the Sox have to win every game from this point on to actually end up at 500. It's not going to happen. So they're going to be below 500, and obviously we're already looking towards next year. So that comes to the question, John, what do the Red Sox have to do in the offseason to try to do something with this team and fix this team?
What do they do, or what do they not do?
Okay.
I have no idea what that means, but let's start off with pitching.
Pitching.
And always pitching. I say it every year, and I hear the same rhetoric every single year. Mm-hmm. People tell me, oh, the Red Sox got plenty of pitching. Plenty of pitching. We don't have a problem. We got Buchholz, Lester, Beckett. We did have Beckett. It's just every year is the same
thing. An all-star at every position.
Exactly. But, the baseball season is 162 games long.
Right.
Injuries happen. Mm-hmm. People eat fried chicken, people sometimes do not perform to what they're capable of performing.
Sure.
I really would like to see the Red Sox go after a marquee pitcher every single year.
Okay.
Or try to go with a pitcher every single year.
Now, what would you say to the people that said, well, they did that. They went after John Lackey, who was the best guy available the season that he came here, and has kind of been a bit of a bust. What would you say to that?
That they acquired him in 2010.
Yeah.
That was the same season that Roy Halladay was available?
Yes.
The Red Sox needed to make a huge play at Roy Halladay.
Okay. So your contention is that he wasn't the guy, that Halladay was the guy.
Absolutely, 100%. The guy is a beast. He leads the league in complete games usually every year.
Right.
If I'm not right about that, you can fact me, CNN. Fact check me, CNN. with a pitcher like that, you can, really rest your bullpen and have your bullpen fresh,
sure.
At least every fifth game or so.
Sure.
But yeah, I mean, 2010, you had Roy Halladay. They didn't make a huge enough push for him. The very next year, in 2011, Cliff Lee was available.
Yep.
They didn't go after him either.
Yep. And in 2011 is when they said that argument.
We all know what they did in 2011 was to go after the offense.
Right.
With Carl Crawford and Adrian Gonzalez.
But 2011 was the year where you heard them saying, we have Buchholz, we have Beckett, we have Dyce, we have Wakefield, we have, so many guys. How could we possibly, where would we even play Cliff Lee?
Right.
And as it turned out, well, probably could have used him a little bit.
Yeah, and Tim Wakefield that year, no stranger to the bullpen. He's been in the bullpen.
Yep.
He's done everything, we've ever asked of him. For the many years he's been on, he's moved around everywhere. So there was room.
So you want the Red Sox to go after a marquee starting pitcher, kind of the stud of the staff, someone to really kind of lead the staff and that kind of thing. Next year's free agent class, not a very good one. really in terms of that stud pitcher, there's only really one that's potentially available. And that's only if the Yankees don't exercise the option, which they probably won't, and that's CeCe Sabathia. Would you go after CeCe Sabathia for the Sox?
That's why I'm not general manager of the Red Sox. I have no idea. I mean, my inside person tells me, yes, go ahead, go for it. Mm-hmm. The Red Sox have freed up plenty of money this offseason by unloading Adrian Gonzalez and Cole Crawford and Beckett and all that. So, I mean, there is money to be spent. Hey, can't forget about him. But, I mean, I just look at the history of the Red Sox acquiring big-name pitchers. 1998 comes to mind when they first acquired Pedro Martinez from the Montreal Expos. I miss the Expos. you know, the year before, 1997,
right.
You know, they were a subpar team. They were below 500. Yep. In fact, this year, this is the first time they're going under 500 since 1997
since that
season.
Team, yep.
They only won 72 games that season. And just by acquiring Pedro Martinez, they won 78. They had 78 wins that season.
Right.
And just by acquiring Pedro Martinez, he was a big factor in the Red Sox winning 92 games in the very next season and making the playoffs in 1998.
Right. Of course, when they got Pedro Martinez, they didn't even know how good he was.
Right.
I mean, he had won a Cy Young with the Expos, and they were able to look into the future and say, this guy has the potential to be the best pitcher in baseball. And lo and behold, you know, in 99, 2000, 2001, not only the best pitcher in baseball, but in my opinion, at least in this man's opinion, the best pitcher ever, maybe.
Ooh.
For those three seasons. I'm not talking over the space of a career, so don't worry, Sandy Koufax, you're safe. But over those three seasons, that I find it hard to believe in steroid era, possibly the best pitcher ever.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, in the era he was pitching, it was just phenomenal what he was doing.
You're
also asking the wrong guy, because me to Pedro Martinez is, you know, John Madden to Brett Favre. You know, I just absolutely love the guy, and he pretty much got me back into baseball. Like,
sure.
I did the Little League, you know, in the 80s and all
right.
that, but I never really took the Red Sox seriously until
Pedro Martinez
joined the team, and, you know, thank God for the wild card.
Right.
That Red Sox can, you know,
yep.
start making the playoffs with being in the same division as the Yankees.
Sure.
But yeah, I mean, so that just like one big impact that year was great, and you can make the case for Curt Schilling as well.
Yep.
We all loved the 2003 Red Sox. You know, cowboy up. but it was the acquisition of Curt Schilling for the 2004 team is when all of this really sat down and just really believed.
And one of the things that happened
that
in 2004,
World Series could happen.
All five starting pitchers that year made all of their starts, not a single pitcher injury that entire year. And that just, as you said, sets up the bullpen and the whole thing fell into place because of the starting pitching.
Yeah.
So, you know, next year for the Red Sox, you already know they're going to have Lester. You already know they're going to have Buchholz. You already know John Lackey is coming back. We'll see what happens with Lackey. You know, reports are he's looking good, but who knows what that means. You know, do you bring Felix DeBrandt back? He's had a pretty good season this year. Do you go out and get that guy on the staff? Can Lester be that guy? My opinion is no. You know, we thought a couple of years ago maybe Lester was that guy. I think Lester's a great number two. He is not a number one in my book. He's not a number one.
Right.
So I think unless the Red Sox get a CC Sabathia or someone of that quality in the free agent market, or they're able to go through trade and pick up a Felix Hernandez or someone like that, mm-hmm. you know, they're going to be their ace of their staff is going to be a number two,
right?
And you know, at least Red Sox history has proven to us, unless we have that stud ace, we're not going anywhere.
Yeah. Acquiring pitchers, you know, it's more of like a crapshoot too.
Sure.
You know, it can pay extremely high dividends once you acquire him, a la Pedro Martinez.
And you talk about Halliday for the Phillies.
Oh,
acquired
absolutely.
Halliday, and that pushed them over the top.
I believe they won the World Series
yes.
before that. But it kept them in contention,
yep.
certainly, with Halliday and Cliff Lee.
Because mm-hmm.
their offense the past few seasons have not been great.
No.
I mean, the Red Sox offense, much better than the Phillies offense. But yeah. they have the pitching to sustain themselves.
Yeah. So just to wrap up, you know, I think we agree on the pitching. Any position players excite you out there? I mean, the Red Sox have been playing basically they've been putting the Pawtucket Red Sox on the field for the last bunch of weeks. To showcase them a little bit for potential trades, as well as to see what they can do for the future. At this point in time, we don't really have a first baseman for next year. We don't have a left fielder. We might, if we bring Cody Ross back, we might have a right fielder. Who knows, you know, anyone out there that you would love to get for the Red Sox as a position player to bolster the offense?
Yeah, with position players, I'm going to have to defer to you, Kevin, with that. I mean, no one really just, you know, strikes me as like, wow, we got to keep this guy forever,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
You know, I like what I see in, you know, Avilés and
Middlebrooks, yeah.
I like what I see in those two guys. And obviously, I mean, everyone loves Dustin Pedroia. He's been,
sure.
you know, one shining, you know,
yeah,
bright spot.
Everyone in likes Ellsbury, of course, you know. Yeah. You know, I think if I were the Red Sox, I would re-sign David Ortiz. You know, whether it's a one-year or two-year deal, I think it's the right thing to do. You're not going to get anybody better to be your DH. And someone brought up, you know, would it be a terrible thing for Ortiz to play first base more often? You know, can you think of an instance where Ortiz has cost them a game when he was playing first base through an error or a mistake or anything like that? He's been okay. He's not the greatest defensive first baseman also, but if you don't have one, you know, putting him out there for 50 games might not be the worst thing in the world.
Hey, you know what? Movon wasn't great at first base either.
Yep, he wasn't, and he won an MVP with the Red Sox, so
he did.
There's nothing wrong with that. Well, okay, this little segment has taken up a good deal of time, but I just wanted to catch your thoughts on, you know, this. We talked about this team being an unlikable team. What would be your favorite Red Sox team of all time?
Favorite Red Sox team? Let's see. well, I'm going to have to, you know, go with the 1999 Red Sox team. I know they didn't win, but as I said and stated before, that it is the team that really brought me back into baseball and into the Red Sox. It got me excited watching Pedro pitch, and it also proves my point about the pitching as well. They used Pedro so much during that postseason that they actually contended. Yep. You know, they passed the first round. They went past Cleveland, basically on Pedro Martinez's arm. And we all know Nomar contributed and Troy O'Leary contributed. Yeah, you know, they had great moments during that that postseason. But it's really Pedro Martinez who really carried that team. And Game 5 comes to mind.
My favorite Red Sox game of all time is Game 5 of the 99 Red Sox against Cleveland. Pedro comes out of the bullpen, pitches those six shutout innings.
Absolutely.
They intentionally walk Nomar to get to Troy O'Leary, load the bases. He hits a grand slam. Do it again later on in the game. Troy O'Leary hits a 2-run or 3-run homer. You know, it's like they didn't learn the first time. You know, great game. I love that game. It was a back and forth. It was a terrific contest.
Right. And Pedro, he was working through an injury that game as well.
Yep.
He pretty much only had his curveball available.
Yep.
I mean, he didn't have his fastball. He didn't have
his changeup,
which is arguably his best pitch. But it's just amazing what he did during that game. And the Red Sox even used him not on the mound. You know, the next round they, you know, faced the Yankees in the AL Championship. And I remember one time the Sox were down. Pedro was not feeling well. His arm was just really not there. They put Pedro in the bullpen, started jumping around. You know, it's just stuff like that the fans started going crazy. They got back into the game and, of course, they didn't pull it out, but it's just I have really good memories of that team. Even.
Well, for me, my favorite Red Sox team of all time would have been the 1978 Red Sox. They didn't win anything again, but that was the team that really got me into the Red Sox. I can still remember watching the games and looking at the lineups and all that. And we could talk another time about, you know, my deep love for the 78 Red Sox. But we need to go to break right now here on The Big Picture. We have some messages from some of our friends, and we want you to take a look at those. We'll be back here in just a moment on The Big Picture on RCTV. Well, welcome back to The Big Picture on RCTV, and we're talking sports. Thanks for watching the messages from our friends here, and now we're back here with Jonathan Vendt. My name is Kevin Vendt, and we're going to talk about a couple of things. Well, we talked about the Red Sox last half, and we never even brought up the manager, Bobby Valentine. Simple question. Does Bobby Valentine come back next year?
I think he might.
Seriously.
I really do think that that 1 year is too soon to mm-hmm. let a manager go. In my heart, I don't want him back. I mean, honestly, this year's Red Sox are making the headlines all for the wrong reasons, and they actually remind me of the New York Jets of last year. he reminds me of Rex Ryan. He has his foot in his mouth all year long, it seems. It seems like he just makes one statement to the press, a la Kevin Youkilis, not putting, giving it his all, and he's saying that, the Red Sox, the Red Sox have had their worst lineup in September ever.
Yeah.
And he just always seems to be explaining himself to the media, and it's just not the right fit, in my opinion.
Sure. However, he also had the whole flap with Joe Madden, and saying Joe Madden doesn't show up to the ballpark on time and all that kind of thing. You're like, what are you talking about? What are you doing?
It's just hilarious the stuff he comes up with. Yeah. And but one thing I do like, and I'm sure you would appreciate this, is that he has set a record, a Red Sox franchise record,
really?
For most ejections in a season.
Sweet.
He's at six right now. Push for number seven. And we love managers getting irate and getting kicked out.
That's one of our favorite things. Managers and coaches getting irate and going after stuff. It's one of our best things.
Yeah.
We love it. Especially NFL coaches. NFL coaches do it better than others, except for Flip Saunders of the Minnesota Timberwolves. He was always the best irate. Okay.
So I don't question his passion for the game.
Sure.
But I personally would not like to see him again, but I'm not sure if the ownership or Ben Charrington feels the same way.
Yeah, the only thing I would give Bobby Valentine any credit for is he's pretty good at evaluating young talent. And whether or not he can nurture that young talent is yet to be seen. I don't know. Well, let's move on. We want to talk a little bit. The NFL season has gotten underway here. We talked in our last show about that, how excited we were with Mr. McCarthy and all that. But we can't start this NFL season off after a couple of weeks without not talking about the replacement referees. Everyone's talking about it, and we'd be remiss not talking about replacement referees. Have they cost any games yet? It's hard to tell. Probably not. Thoughts on replacement referees?
Well, I do think that they have a bullseye on the back of their head. I know there's a lot of grumbling around the league talking about the replacement refs, but I think they might have been seen in an unfair way. Mm-hmm. However, there has been many, many controversial calls since they have taken over for the first 2 weeks of the season. I've heard that, they've found out that one was actually a Saints fan.
Right.
He's been posting pictures online with Saints gear on, but they did get rid of him before the game
before
started.
And
there's also been rumors that LeSean McCoy of the Philadelphia Eagles had a little conversation with one ref who claimed that LeSean McCoy was on his fantasy team, and pretty sure that's against the rules of the NFL.
I would think that probably is. but what do you, what? I guess you said they have a target on their back. Is it because everyone knows they're not really the best guys out there, or are they really screwing up that bad?
Well, I think it's a little bit of both. Yeah. They do have the target, which is understandable. It's something that's out of the ordinary. So
sure.
When something goes awry or not your way, you're going to look to blame someone, and
right.
they're absolutely the easiest people to blame. But on the other hand, yeah, there has been botched calls.
Mm-hmm.
The four timeouts given to our old friend Pete Carroll.
Our old Pete Carroll, who I personally believe he played that situation to see what would happen.
I think there's some substance to that as well.
Well, good for him. I mean, that's what he's supposed to do. He's the coach. He's supposed to try to get any advantage he could. I'm not blaming him. It's not his fault the refs didn't know the rules.
Right. Again, that has happened twice before in the last decade. But
right.
then again, that's only twice. In the last 10 years, and that there's 16 regular season games
times
the amount of teams and all that. So it's a very rare event, and it just so happens to happen on, the first week of the replacement refs. It's a time issue. I believe most calls, they eventually get right, but a lot of the calls have to be challenged. And it just takes them a while to actually get the right call.
It seems as though they don't quite have a 100% grasp of exactly what they're doing sometimes. Even in the Sunday night game, where they misplaced the ball 6 yards.
Right.
And did it change the game? There's no way to tell. Probably not. You know, it's not as though the Broncos went and scored a touchdown. They did kick a field goal. Was the field goal easier because it was 6 yards closer? You know, would they have gotten that anyway? There's no way to know. But it seems as though the games just aren't as smooth as they typically are. You know, they're herky-jerky, and they have these long timeouts where they're trying to figure out what they're doing and what happened and all that kind of thing.
And it's confusing for the players.
Yeah.
And the coaches involved. You know, they're not in the same rhythm as they're used to. I remember one time, the Washington Redskins game against the St. Louis Rams. Mm-hmm. You know, they had Josh Morgan throw the ball at what's his name? Cortland Finnegan from the Rams.
Yeah.
After Cortland Finnegan pushed him.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, yeah, that did warrant a penalty.
Sure.
But I'm not so sure if Josh Morgan would have been singled out.
Right.
In that instance.
Right.
You know, they gave him position to kick a field goal. But you know, our old friend Cundiff, Bill Cundiff,
missed
the field goal, so it didn't change the game. It was a 62-yarder, so we'll forgive him for that one. But, you know, I mean, are these calls game-changing yet? I don't think so. Next week, maybe, it might happen.
That's where it's going to come down to, is if a call is blown in such a way that a game is changed and a game is lost or a game is won, and then that has effect on potentially playoff position or even making the playoffs, and that's when people are really going to get up irate.
Yes.
About it. Is when that happens. You know, I'm going to go into my Kevin irate rant at this point, because I just want to talk about the regular officials for a moment. They're in a contract dispute with the NFL, and I get that, I understand. But let's just talk about officials for a moment. They make $8,000 a game, which means if they do 16 games, okay, they make $128,000 a year for 16 days of work. We'll give them the benefit of the doubt and say that maybe they spend a day studying every week too. Okay, so for 2 days a week, for 5 months out of the year, all right, they're going to make $128,000 on average. Now, those who play the playoffs are going to make $8,000 a game for 1, 2, 3, or potentially 4 games if they go to the Super Bowl. So they can go up to, you know, whatever 4 times 8 is, another $32,000. Okay, so for, you know, potentially, you know, $150,000-$160,000 that they could make in a season for a 5-6 month period. I don't know about you, but 128 grand a year for 16 or maybe 30 days of work sounds pretty good. One of the big issues of contention is that the NFL wants to move the officials from a pension plan to a 401k. Okay, now these are part-time employees. I can't think of any other part-time employees that get a pension plan. You're a full-time employee of a large American corporation. You have a 401k, right?
I do.
You don't have a pension plan.
No.
Why should officials be different than the rest of America? I understand sports is different, you know, and we all get that. At the same time, you know, they got to live in reality also. So there's my rant against the officials. NFL, let's fix this. Let's move on. Let's try to get these games back to normal. We're getting sick of watching them.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, though the ratings are up everywhere, eventually it's going to come back to hurt them.
Yeah.
So that's my rant of the day. And we're going to move on from there on this rant. The definition of elite quarterback comes to mind in the NFL. This is something I talk about and I kind of rant about too a little bit. You know, it's kind of thrown around. We were counting a couple days ago, and we counted no less than 15 or 16 quarterbacks that had been listed as elite quarterbacks or near elite quarterbacks, which I find hard to believe given there's only 30 starting quarterbacks in the league. 14, 15, 16 of them cannot possibly be elite quarterbacks. So the question is this: who are the elite quarterbacks in the NFL? If you had to choose, my definition of an elite quarterback is this: there are 30 starters, only 3, maybe 4, can be elite. So 10% plus 1, 4 can be elite. Who would you put on that list?
Well, let's go with the obvious ones
first.
Us as Patriots fans.
Yeah.
Let's go with Tom Brady.
Okay.
He's absolutely elite. You know, he's won 3 Super Bowls, been in 5.
Mm-hmm. 2 MVPs.
2 MVPs as well. Peyton Manning should be up there.
Peyton Manning has 4 MVPs, has won 1 Super Bowl.
Yep, all right. And Drew Brees comes to mind.
Drew Brees, 1 Super Bowl win, no MVPs.
Ooh, no MVPs.
No MVPs.
So we might have to rethink that.
Yeah. You also have, you know, the other ones that I brought up that I think are in the potential running. You have Aaron Rodgers.
Absolutely.
1 MVP, 1 Super Bowl win. Ben Roethlisberger, 2 Super Bowl wins. Eli Manning, 2 Super Bowl wins. I think the rest of them, you can't put anyone else in that category. None of the rest of them have any Super Bowl wins. None of the rest of them have any MVPs. That's who you're talking about. Of those six guys, can we pick three or four of them to be elite?
I think three would probably be the easiest ones. I think it's the fourth one we're going to have trouble.
Okay, so you're three.
I say Tom Brady.
Yep.
Aaron Rodgers.
Yep.
And Peyton Manning.
Okay.
Okay, I mean, I say Peyton Manning due to what he's done the past decade.
We'll see what happens.
Yeah. Right, okay. So that leaves the fourth one.
The fourth one, Breeze, Roethlisberger, Eli Manning. Who do you like?
Living in New England, how can you not say Eli Manning?
Why?
Because he's beaten the greatest team on earth twice. he may not have the stats as the other ones do. He frequently turns the ball over, but he does come up big in the biggest of stages.
Okay. Well, there we go. John's opinion, Manning, Brady, Rodgers, Eli Manning as your four elite quarterbacks in the NFL. I can't put Eli Manning in that class.
I didn't think you would.
I'm going to go with Drew Brees as my fourth. So I'm going to take the same three. I'm going to go with Drew Brees as my fourth. Even though he has less Super Bowl wins, I just think he's more talented. And that's just a feeling. I don't have any other stats beyond yardage and consistency and all that kind of stuff. I just feel as though he's more consistent. He's a better quarterback.
And you know what's an interesting point? I know the season is young, but taking the four quarterbacks that you yep. picked out and I picked out,
yep.
They are having so far subpar seasons.
They are. Every single one of them is.
Every single one of
every
them
single one.
Is below of what they normally
sure.
put out. So there's risers coming, so we don't know who's going to be elite in the next, 5 years or so.
Right.
So
we can only take a look at where we're at right now.
Absolutely. I think our list is pretty good for the past 6 or so years.
Okay. All right. Well, we are out of time here on The Big Picture. We have a lot more things to talk about, but we'll have to come back and talk about them another time. So we thank you for watching us tonight. We hope that you have found it informative and found it interesting, and we hope that you'll continue to watch us. My name is Kevin Vendt. I'm the host of The Big Picture here on RCTV. Have a good day.